Stephen Buchanan could have been one of the most dangerous predators to surface in our investigation in Fairfield, Connecticut. We knew from our research before he arrived at our sting house that he had access to guns. We took precautions. As you're about to see, Buchanan was cagey.
The guy we're about to analyze is a dark and puzzling mystery, easily one of the scariest scumbags to ever appear on Hansen vs. Predators. Stephen Buchanan is known for the frightening items he brought with him to the sting house. So of course, I have to analyze this fucker. In this video, I'll explore the popular theory that Stephen Buchanan was a serial killer whose weapons of choice were found in a kill kit in the trunk of his car. Along the way, I'll highlight his odd mannerisms and see what we can learn from the scary way that he speaks. So shout out to Takes for the chat log and phone call, and shout out to Walls for the raw footage. And without any further ado, let's watch this guy's future get murdered. So the clothes that he's wearing. The jeans, fairly average, and then the hoodie, of course, fairly average as well. Nothing about the clothes that he's wearing screams that he's going to commit a crime. But him wearing a hoodie, certainly, it doesn't help the case that he's not doing anything bad. A person who's trying to avoid being recognized can just very easily throw on a hoodie. So the fact that he's wearing a hoodie means that he might be intending on not wanting to be seen by others. That might have been a strategic choice for apparel rather than just a coincidence, him wearing a sweatshirt. Of course, there's nothing wrong with wearing a hoodie, but it's like, if you were going to do something shady, of course you'd want a fucking hoodie. He's just waiting outside. He doesn't want to come in.
I'm sorry. Don't.
And he actually texted her to say, "I'm outside." So he was already talking about taking her somewhere else. So he was not even trying to go into the house.
Please. All right. I'm just so freaked out about the whole gun thing after today.
I heard.
My cousin was in Newtown.
Newtown. Oh fuck! That's the shooting.
Can you just like prove to me right now that you...
That's a very good way to add credibility to her story. The fact that she specifically said my cousin was in Newtown. Of course, that was the, I believe, Sandy Hook shooting, the tragic shooting there. So for her to say that, it gives credibility for him to believe that she's really freaked out. She didn't need to put that line in there. That was probably the decoy, just either riffing or maybe they gave her that line. But either way, that is a compelling argument that she could make to this guy about why she's scared of the gun and why she needs to make sure that he doesn't have one.
You don't have a gun.
And then of course the other dude fucking has his hand on his gun. He's fucking ready for some shit to just go down. He's like thinking it's gonna be a standoff or something.
Prove to me right now that you don't have a gun. You turn around. It's not your sweatshirt, you swear?
You swear? He's all, yeah, I swear. Scout's honor. Okay. Why the fuck would anyone trust what Steve Buchanan says?
Okay, I'm sorry. I don't want you to think I'm crazy.
She's extremely nervous too. You could tell from her voice. I mean, she's like nervous Nelly. She's kind of characterized by how nervous she gets. Even though she's like definitely one of the best decoys they have, she does get nervous as hell.
No, I trust. I understand.
Okay. Do you want to come in?
You want to go?
Can you just like come in and we can chat for a little bit? I feel really weird about just like piecing it out of here right now.
I can come right there and chat. I'm not coming in.
Okay, yeah.
So the fact that he refuses to go in, he was talking about having sex with a decoy, but he doesn't want to come into the house. So he wanted to take the decoy into his car and then go through with having sex with the decoy. The fact that he doesn't want to go into the house doesn't mean that he had PG-13 intentions. It means he had fucking rated X intentions, but they just weren't going to occur at the house.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, I'm right here.
I'm in right here. It sounds like he's drunk.
So great to meet you.
Why?
Done this before.
Sure.
See, so the fact that she's extremely nervous, it doesn't even raise any suspicion. It'd probably raise more suspicion if she was calm. So it's almost in character for her to be nervous as fuck.
Makes me feel a little better. Do you like want water or anything?
No.
She's so fidgety.
Yeah.
Can you tell I'm nervous?
Oh, I'm nervous.
She's all, dude, I'm nervous.
It's raining. I feel so bad.
It's alright.
What do you want to do?
I'll throw you out there for
I think in the chat that he had with the decoy, he almost has like an obsession with safety. It was kind of strange. He insisted on showing the decoy what areas were safe and what areas were not safe, like what areas were ghetto as fuck. But of course, it's paradoxical that he, a predator, is trying to endanger this person, but he paradoxically has this obsession with showing her areas that are unsafe. That's very interesting that he does that. It also supports a different argument that I'm going to make later on.
Oh, Westport, you got some food if you want.
Like what?
I don't know, what do you like?
I just ate not that hungry.
What do you like?
I'm not like that hungry.
You wanna show you around?
I feel so weird about moving. I'm sure you don't want to hear me.
This is a stalemate. Neither side wants to give up ground. She is just making, this is a line in the sand, and she's not going to cross it, and he doesn't want to cross it. Of course, it's eventually going to end with him losing, but he does not want to go in the house right now.
Get to know each other, and then we go from there, you know?
It's just be driving around, you know?
It's up to you.
Very interesting that she says the driving around. It's not necessarily the driving around. It's just going anywhere with him. It's just being alone with him in any capacity that's actually scary. It's not simply the operation of an automobile.
Like I said, I don't have nothing on me.
Yeah, I trust you.
You know? What about this?
I trust you.
I have an umbrella.
She obviously doesn't trust him as well. If Stephen would have been like, oh, you trust me, then why don't you get the car? So the fact that she said she trusts him, maybe she just means I trust you to not have a gun.
I have an umbrella, but I'll go for a walk.
But someone might be watching us right now.
Up
and down this lighted road,
but
that's
like
it.
Walking in the rain at night? People don't do that.
I saw 10 people walking around.
Some people do that. I know. What did you say here? I saw 10 people walking around already.
People don't do that.
I saw like 10 people walking already.
She should have objected and been like, actually, Steven, that's the bandwagon logical fallacy. Just because there are 10 people doing it doesn't mean that we should do it.
It's running. It's not pouring.
I'm not all logical with
this. It's like not even a drizzle. I'll show you the umbrella.
Oh, wow. Okay, so not only... So he's making two arguments as to why she should go outside on this walk. He's saying, oh, so everyone else is doing it on one hand. And then on the other hand, it's not even raining that bad. So the second argument's a mitigation. This guy's trying to be an effective debater. And he's
I believe you have an umbrella, yeah.
That's it. You know, this way, if you get used to each other, if you don't like it, you go home and I'll leave.
You just stay here. I have food, you can just hang out, watch a movie. What about going to the movie?
See, it's not about the movie. It has nothing to do with the movie. It's about being alone with him. He's insisting each proposition that he's giving out has to do with him departing in some way alone with her, whether it's in a vehicle, whether it's on foot. So it's very suspicious already for the case. Why is he so insistent upon this? It doesn't help the case that he didn't have plans to murder her. It certainly casts him in a poor light. His insistence that the decoy depart alone with him at night.
No, like I'm pretty sure some of my friends are going tonight, and if we ran into them, that would be the worst thing. Where?
The worst.
I don't think so. I'd rather just stay here. I want to hang out with you, but like I'm just so scared.
Why?
Why?
This She's crazy. Also, you
I've never
fucking
done it.
Idiot.
I'm so scared.
Why?
Why? This is crazy.
You could tell that she was like smiling, even though her fucking back is turned to us. You could tell that as soon as she said that, her eyes widened and she started smiling, and that must have been like her actually going like, dude, are you fucking serious? Like that was the most like shocked response that she could give. She's all, dude, do I really need to explain this to you?
But like, I'm just so scared.
Why?
This is crazy. I've never done anything like
this.
What do you want to do?
Oh, they had to do. Yeah. So not all the predators do this. This is a move that Stephen Moffat does as well. That go get your library card. That guy was also a really reluctant and suspicious predator, more of a paranoid predator. So Stephen Buchanan is definitely more, well, This is a moment to where he's either on one hand just being a paranoid predator, and that's the reluctance he has to come in the house, or he wants to take the decoy somewhere so he could carry out a murder. I guess there are two different trains of why he might insist on taking the decoy somewhere, or why he's at least showing reluctance as to why he's going to come in.
What if I-62? Is
it parking lot? That's sketchy, dude.
Are you serious?
I'm serious. Did you like that?
I don't know. Don't crash your car, though.
It's a parking lot. There's gonna be nothing there.
Oh, you could crash in a parking lot, dude. It's very fucking easy. You could hit like an embankment, or you could hit a light. You could hit a fucking car. It's very easy.
I'm pretty clumsy. It could happen.
You're gonna put your trust in me and come with me. I want to put my trust in my car.
Oh, that's reciprocity. Right? he's using reciprocity.
It's up to you.
That's a common, that's a very common element in communication. It's like self-disclosure. When someone opens up to you with like a secret, it's only natural to maybe feel comfortable to respond with telling them a secret about yourself in some capacity. Obviously not to hijack the conversation, like talking about whatever about they're saying. But like we oftentimes in communication use reciprocity to strengthen relationships with people.
I really don't think I can leave. Sorry, I feel so bad.
I feel so bad. Okay. Nice, she's drawing a line. She's like, dude, I'm not coming out.
Please come in.
And then she's done. She fucking tags Chris.
Why don't you take a seat right over there?
And then this Rod Knight, the security dude. Normally, when the predator comes in, it's just Chris. And that means that the predator wonders, is this her dad? Well, I guess he would know as soon as Chris Hansen comes out from talking to him that it's not the dad and he's holding this. But nonetheless, the additional element of this guy shows that this is a police sting. At this moment, Buchanan is near certain that what's going on is a police sting and that he's about to get fucked. The men are being respectful. They're not being nice, but they're being respectful. Chris isn't being explicitly coercive with them. I mean, he's being firm with them, but he's not yelling at him or telling him that he's going to beat his ass. So Buchanan is going to look at the professional demeanor and conduct of both of these guys and know that he's talking to people who are either working for law enforcement or who are affiliated with law enforcement in some way.
Please take your hands out of your pockets.
Prince. Take your hands out of your pockets.
What was on the agenda tonight?
I was just going to take her out and show her around.
Take her out and show her around where?
Fairfield.
Sure. Very defensive posture on him. He's already kind of arching his back and he's keeping both of his hands in plain sight. Of course, Chris is standing up and casually leaning against the table, looming over him. This demonstrates the asymmetrical relationship of power to which he's getting fucking wrecked by Chris Hansen. He's Chris Hansen's bitch right now, and it's very clear just from the arrangement of these two people.
That's it.
And what exactly were you going to show her?
The beach. The beach.
He was going to go to the beach with Michael Willis.
What are you going to show her?
The beach.
He was just on his way to the beach. Hey, what? No way.
Like Bridgeport, P.T. Barnum.
So you're the welcome wagon here in Fairfield. You're just going to do a favor for a 13-year-old girl.
Chris looks like a fucking pissed off soccer mom right there.
Do a favor for a 13-year-old girl.
Well,
this guy's... Okay,
what happened was,
that's a concession. And that at this moment, Buchanan realized that he was not going to be able to talk his way out of the situation.
What happened was, when my cousin came,
right,
she did the same thing.
So the Daniel Pulido defense.
She did the same thing.
The argument that, oh, this happened to someone in my family, and therefore I was trying to prevent this from happening to someone else's family. Bullshit, dude. If you look at the chat, he was explicitly talking about sexual topics. He was talking about having sex. He talked about fucking recording having sex with the decoy. So he was clear and adamant and persistent about his intention to have sex with the decoy. So for him to come over and say that he was going to try and talk the decoy out of it is bullshit.
Thing.
You, when your cousin came, she did the same
it's
thing.
It's always the cousin, too.
What's this?
She invited
an older person.
An older person came over and showed your 13-year-old.
This guy's like indirectly referencing all these fucking To Catch a Predator. He's talking about the beach. Now he's talking about his cousin. He needs to chill. This is like the Predator multiverse, like too much, dude.
What happened in that case?
The universes are colliding.
She got assaulted.
And I was in the army. I don't like people doing that.
So let me get this straight. You had a cousin who was 13 who moved to town here.
Stratford. Yes.
Right, Stratford. And sickeningly, Stratford was also the city from which he was trying to become a police officer in. So at the time when he showed up to get fucked in the ass by Chris Hansen, he was awaiting becoming a police officer in Stratford, Connecticut. That is also something that I'll go into a little bit later, but that does not fucking support the claim that he didn't have intent to murder the decoy. Yes.
And she was contacted by an adult.
Yes.
Who picked her up and sexually assaulted her.
Not sexually assaulted her, but was holding hands and stuff like that, and she got scared.
And she told you about this?
Yes.
And you decided, because you're former military and still in the National Guard, right?
Yes.
That you were going to come over and show this 13-year-old girl around.
Oh, Chris is using some fucking jazzy movements right there.
And show this 13-year-old girl around.
He does like a very wild gesture with his hands.
And show this 13-year-old girl
very powerful.
So she'd be safe.
Yes.
Chris doing that just represents the fucking absurdity. Chris's nonsensical hand gesture represents the metaphorical absurdity and nonsensical nature of his fucking argument, of Buchanan's argument.
And you want me to buy that?
I'm telling you the truth, sir.
Buchanan says he showed up because he had a 13-year-old girl cousin who was molested by a man she met online, and he didn't want the same thing to happen to our young decoy. But the logs of his chat tell a much different story.
Yes,
and so
clearly.
What is all this talk back and forth between you and a girl you think is 13? You know you're going to shower with me Thursday night. What night is this?
Oh, that's good.
I'm gonna pick you.
That's logical reasoning.
What night is this?
That's so fucking good.
Thursday night. What night is this?
So Stephen Buchanan will shower with the decoy on Thursday night. And then the next proposition, it is Thursday night. Therefore, Stephen will shower with the decoy. Chris just laid out like a little fucking logical proposition to demonstrate that this guy had intent on the night that he showed up to the steakhouse.
I'm going to pick you up and put you against the shower wall.
He's looking at him.
Then I'm going to have you ride me, babe, as my hand grabs your ass and I
your blank ass.
Your blanks. Did you send her any pictures of yourself?
He's so defeated. He has this, despite saying very little, he's communicating a vast amount just through his nonverbals. He's looking down. His hands are in plain sight of Chris. He knows that Chris is suspicious of him, so almost as a gesture of good faith, subconsciously, I believe that Steve Buchanan is presenting his hands to Chris as if to say, look, I'm being as cooperative as I can. I'm sitting down and I'm playing your game. I'm going along with the rules that you're throwing out right now. He's not saying anything.
Can you talk about actually having sex with her and Skyping it to an ex-boyfriend?
And that shows a lot about his personality and about the relationship that he has with others. He insisted that the decoy have sex with them and that he film the decoy having sex with them, and then the decoy would Skype her ex-boyfriend. That is pure sadism. So it's interesting to explore what enticed him about that particular fantasy. It's almost more about having power and inflicting suffering on the ex-boyfriend than it is even about fulfilling his own pleasure. Having sex with the decoy would satisfy the pleasure aspect of his desire. So the desire to film it and then send it to the ex-boyfriend, to the decoy's hypothetical ex-boyfriend, of course, doesn't exist. But his desire to inflict pain on that individual is a completely separate motivation. And it's a very dark motivation that, once again, does not portray him in a positive light. It shows that he likes inflicting pain on other people.
Now, that doesn't exactly back up your...
But of course, I guess so do I, because I fucking laugh at people like him. But at least the people that I talk shit on are fucking evil and deserve everything that I say.
Your story about being the protector of Fairfield County, Connecticut, does it? I'm listening.
He's all, dude, come on.
No, sir.
Sir, so he's introducing an element of respect because he's been in the military. Calling people sir is probably something that he's used to, because he's wanted to be a cop. He wanted to, continue to have this government job. So calling people sir is something that he does as a sign of respect. So him doing that is just another. It's a fucking little small piece of his overall submissive, complete lack of resistance on his part.
But what am I to make of this?
He's given up.
A horrible lapse in judgment. How old are you?
And it's really unfair to say that it's a horrible lapse in judgment. It's not just one lapse in judgment. What he did was have a fucking series of lapses of judgments. Every time that he opened up his phone and every time that he started typing anything was a lapse in judgment. So for him to say it's a lapse of judgment is not fucking accurate. It was a long, wide-ranging series of lapses of judgment.
And what do you do for a living?
I work for Cablevision.
Cablevision. And what do you do for Cablevision?
I'm a maintenance worker.
You're a maintenance worker. And what did you do in the National
Guard? A maintenance worker.
I was a truck driver.
That's very sketchy. So him being a maintenance worker for a cable company means that he probably went to people's houses and fixed their cable. The serial killer BTK worked for an alarm company. As dark as that is, even though he was a serial killer, he went into people's houses and inspected their alarm systems. So him having a job where he could go into people's homes, it would also satisfy the dark desire to just be voyeuristic and to watch people. It could have been a means for him to scope out potential victims and to know the lay of their house, which is exactly what Dennis Rader did, the BTK killer did.
Truck driver. And you were in the military before that.
Yes.
Oh my God.
Cablevision.
I'm a maintenance worker.
You're a maintenance worker. And what did you do in the National Guard?
I was a truck driver.
Truck driver.
And similarly, truck drivers have been looked at for the ability to find victims and to essentially like be serial killers. The FBI has showed a particular interest when suspects are truck drivers. When if a person is a suspect of a murder and then it's found out that they're a truck driver, like, that raises additional eyebrows. Of course, there's nothing wrong with being a truck driver, but it's just a type of job that people who are serial killers are drawn to, just because of the ease of finding people and of carrying out their murders.
And you were in the military before that.
And the military is another. And help the police is another. Of course, these guys who are serial killers, they want to understand the criminal justice system to get away with their acts. So they have an interest in police work. Anyone who wants to be a police officer, like, you have to understand the law. And people who break the law, they also need to understand how to evade being arrested. So if he were to become a police officer, he would know how the police operate. He would know, even more so than others, how to carry out a successful crime, because he knows what the police are looking for. He would have access to insider information that would make it so much easier for him to carry out murders without anyone ever knowing.
Understand what it was that really brought you
to- like, every job this guy's had is like a fucking strike against him, and actually displays some relationship on some level with people who've been serial killers. That's crazy.
I mean, explain it to me.
I haven't been the same since I deployed to Iraq.
Oh, and then that excuse.
It's tough stuff over there.
I haven't been the same.
Where were you in Iraq?
Mosul.
Mosul.
Camp Mirez.
Oh, that was it.
Action.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
How did that impact you?
And that is just him deploying the poor me defense. As soon as he brings up PTSD and his military service, Chris realizes, oh fuck, now I gotta put on the gloves, because I can't go as hard as I was. Immediately, the entire nature of the exchange changes when he introduces his PTSD and his military service, because it goes from being more about an accusation to him trying to explain what he's done, which is also what he did at court. I'll go into that later, but this guy has no shame, and him using PTSD is not just something that he used for Chris. Him using it as an excuse, which is of course bullshit, is not just something he did for Chris.
Did you get help for it?
I tried, but But the VA situation, what? They just weren't helpful.
Yeah, see, because a person will hear that and think, oh yeah, that sucks. Like, the VA has had a lot of problems historically delivering the kind of care that veterans deserve. Nonetheless, even though we can agree with that, anytime we agree with what the predator says, I think on a subconscious level, it's almost them trying to make their case to us. So it's important to recognize that for being a rhetorical, for what it is, it's a rhetorical strategy. It's just him trying to deflect and trying to identify with people. He's trying to say something that we all identify with and agree with. But of course, that's him just trying to be manipulative.
I thought I could just
write it out.
Roger.
Was it PTSD?
Roger.
It's just, I don't know, I do have problems sleeping at night.
That's very common for me.
See, and it is very common. That's why he's saying it.
At night. I have problems, you know, waking up when I do go to sleep. And when I do sleep and I wake up in the middle of the night, I have problems going back to sleep. It's just, I try to talk to people about it, and they always just tell me, suck it up.
And that's tragic,
while
too.
While Buchanan said that he suffered PTSD because of his service in Iraq, somehow he was able to hold down a job at a local cable company and even be on a list for employment as a police officer in Connecticut.
And I kind of disagree with what Chris is implying there. Chris isn't explicitly saying it, but he's basically saying that Buchanan does not have PTSD. I think that's fucked. Buchanan probably does have PTSD. The argument should be that PTSD had nothing to do with him being a predator, and it had nothing to do with him showing up to meet Bailey. So instead of just disputing that he has PTSD, yeah, I would say that no, he probably does, and that the two are completely unrelated. But given his exposure to probably real threats and trauma, he probably does have PTSD. It's very common. And the fact that he could hold down a job and function doesn't mean that he didn't have PTSD. It just means that he was able to give a veneer of doing well.
I've never been to war, so I can't pass judgment on PTSD or any long-lasting effects. I can't. But I still have a difficult time connecting that to trying to sexually solicit a 13-year-old girl.
There you go. See, and Chris, it's like, dude, let's stop talking about PTSD and let's start talking about what you did.
I was never like this.
And then he goes right back.
PTSD? I know people get depressed. I know people have drug and alcohol.
He's not willing.
You read about it all the time, you see it. But that doesn't mean it's okay.
God, everything's like a tug of war with this guy. First, there's a fucking tug of war between him going into the house and the decoy insisting. And now there's a tug of war in which he keeps wanting to talk about PTSD. And Chris is trying to talk about what he did.
For you to go try to solicit sex with a 13-year-old girl. You understand my logic.
I completely understand. I completely understand.
Well, help me to
it's fair logic. It's correct.
Someone just goes off inside of my head where I'm fine 1 second, and then this next second I'm having different thoughts and stuff like that.
Did you have these thoughts before you were in Iraq?
No.
So what he's describing could very well be PTSD, but it has nothing to do with the kind of conversation that he had with the decoy. If a person perceives some kind of threat and they responded to that threat in a way that was different than the normal response, that might have been PTSD. So as soon as he saw Chris Hansen, if he would have had an exceptionally defensive response, and people with PTSD don't do this normally, but if he would have perhaps acted aggressively physically with Chris, just because he saw a threat and he perhaps felt like he needed to neutralize the threat, that might have been able to be supported by, oh, well, that was a response of the PTSD. But the long conversations that he had with the decoy and then showing up, completely unrelated to the symptoms that he's describing right now. What he's describing right now might be PTSD, but it is unrelated in every way to the chat.
And how many times have you done this?
Honestly,
not a good answer.
Honestly.
It's my first.
Your first time.
First time. Honestly.
The problem with that, Stephen, is that you surfaced talking in a very similar way to a girl named Brittany posing as a 13-year-old.
Who's Brittany?
I have that chat, too.
Yes, I understand.
So I said, you just lied to me.
No,
we have Bailey and we have Brittany. This is Bailey.
What the fuck? This is my first time doing it on a chat site.
This is my first time on a chat site.
Talking.
Yes, I understand. I'm saying all together. First time
he's just loving them together like fucking set theory. He's saying like the two different decoys are a set. They're a part of one set. So even if there's two decoys, they equal one action. That's bullshit though, dude. Chris is calling you out for just doing it on two different occasions with two decoys.
I like this.
So these two girls were the first time.
Right. See, exactly.
And you decided to come visit Bailey tonight.
It's like the two that I did was the first time. Dude, it doesn't work like that.
Did you bring condoms?
No, I did not.
But your intent seems pretty clear.
And yes, he did. He did bring condoms.
Yes, but like then I told her after I thought about it again, I told her we weren't going to do nothing tonight.
You went from whisper to kick to your cell phone.
And he sent a fucking dick pic as soon as he went to kick. So his intent was transparent.
That's a long time. A lot of effort.
It begun on whisper and then evolved into kick. And when it went to kick, he... started off with the dick pic.
Yes. But I didn't tell her that I had, after thinking, I had no intentions, just showing her around.
Showing her around.
But that...
showing her where not to go because he loves safety.
In the text.
It should be.
Your intent is...
And so, paradoxically, he insists on taking the decoy to... show where is okay and where is not okay to be. Like he insisted in the chat on taking the decoy to certain locations that she shouldn't go because they're ghetto. He kept talking about, oh, these areas are unsafe. And then before he even showed up to the house, he canvassed, he walked the block in fucking circles, just like walking around the house. And then his reluctance to go inside, this guy very well might perceive threats in all kinds of places. He might have, that's another indicator that he might have PTSD. He very well may be honest when he says he has PTSD, even though it doesn't excuse what he fucking did.
Can I show you?
But then of course, him wanting to take the decoy also could have been him trying to take her to a location so he could fucking murder her, so.
I don't want you to reach in your pocket.
Can you reach him?
He's like, dude, we don't trust you, man.
Please have some.
So now this fucker is gonna find one random cherry-picked text that he sent that shows a little bit of reluctance, not even a denial, but just reluctance, and he's gonna point to that as a demonstration of his intent and ignore the fucking 99% of shit that incriminates him in the chat. And he finds it. Yeah, you gotta work hard to cherry-pick.
No hooking up whatsoever.
I know, but you know what that sounds like to me? It sounds like somebody who's trying to create
some kind of
a plausible excuse after all the other graphic.
His mouth open, it never closes.
And at the end of the day, you showed up. After circling the house,
I understand.
You circled the house, you pulled in the driveway, you pulled
out. Exactly, and the circling of the house shows that he's cautious. So he might be circling the house because he is just suspicious that it's a setup. Although I don't think that was the case. He didn't really show that he was reluctant because it was a setup as much as it seemed like he just wanted to be in control of the situation. His reluctance to come into the home, I don't believe that it was the product of him thinking it was Chris Hansen. I think he didn't want to come into the home because in the car outside, it allows him to have control of the situation.
You wanted her to get in the car with you, not even having met.
Yeah.
That's a little creepy, I gotta tell you, Steve.
I understand.
Yeah, dude.
And I did not bring any condoms with me.
Well, that doesn't mean anything, really, does it?
Even though he did.
What else did you bring?
Nothing.
Just yourself?
Yes.
While Buchanan told me he didn't bring condoms, police later found them in his car, along with a loaded handgun, duct tape, and a camera. Think about that.
You see all this.
And then that goes back to the kill kit that I mentioned in the beginning. So those items are oftentimes used for what serial killers will call like a kill kit or their hit kit. Basically just the items that they're going to use when they carry out their murders for whatever the weapons are, whatever restraints or whatever fucking items they use. These fuckers will oftentimes just have it in one assembled package, like in a backpack or in something that allows them to have access to everything at once. Him possessing the items that he had, the gun and the fucking duct tape and the camera and everything else, it looks extremely bad. And although these things don't necessarily mean that he was going to use them all, it certainly allows us to ask the question if he was going to use them all in the first place.
Looks right.
Yes, I know.
So what do you think should happen?
Bring me down.
Bring me down?
To the police station.
To the police station? Yeah, well, you should be familiar with it, dude. Remember when you applied there?
Something God, else.
I can't even imagine the people that he talked to at the Stratford Police Department. If they heard about that, fuck. That would be so fucked. That would reflect so poorly. That would reflect. It's horrible to think about.
I'm Chris Hansen. And this is an investigation called Hansen versus Predator.
And he's wrecked.
Yes, I understand.
Is there anything else you want people to know about your situation tonight?
Don't do what I did.
Don't do what I did.
Don't do what I did.
And are you going to try to get some help?
Yes.
And I have your word on that. Yeah.
Wow, I'll that's the second hand. Time that Chris... And then he goes to shake his hand.
All right, Stephen.
Chris didn't shake his hand. He ignored him.
And I have your word on that.
Yeah. I'll shake your hand. Everything.
So that was not even an attempt to shake Chris's hand. That was just more of like an impotent attempt to show that Buchanan has no interest in trying to jam Chris up. Like he's going to go with the program.
You're free to go.
And Chris isn't even looking at him.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, yeah. He does. He really extends it. Okay.
Grab your phone. You can go out the door right there.
Police department.
Yep, and then there are the cops. He's getting fucked now. They're patting him down. The same people that he wanted to work for.
Where's your car, Steve? Right up front.
There's nothing wrong with wanting to be a police officer, right? But the kind of person who wants to have control over other people, they oftentimes are attracted to being a police officer. Because police do, they have explicit control over people.
We're gonna talk.
It is so defeated.
You explain some things to me, we'll get some information from you. We'll go step by step, okay? Okay? Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
I do have my permit on it.
You have your permit on it?
Yes.
Is a weapon in the car?
Yes. It's in the...
Hey guys, where is it?
It's in the trunk.
His weapons are in the trunk.
He's all, dude, he's got a stash in the trunk.
Someone's going to have to come down and help with that process, right? So it's going to be something that you need to call and do.
Oh, wow.
So you'll have to make a decision now, but just...
Excellent. I know what the officer's saying is not a coincidence. Well, if you're going to be bonded out, I would imagine there's someone going to have to come down and help that process. Steven eventually, I found an article online that said that he lost his girlfriend over the experience. So presumably, Steven is thinking about how he's going to break the news to his girlfriend that he's been caught trying to do this. So right now, the cop is just saying, hey, by the way, the worst part about this isn't going to be your stay in jail. It's going to be the ripple effect that all the consequences are going to have on your life. You're going to lose everything. So he's saying, hey, remember, do you have a girlfriend? Because if you have a girlfriend, you could basically fucking consider that relationship over.
So it's going to be somebody that need to call and not do it.
He's telling him. So you think your girlfriend's going to help you right now?
Just start thinking about it. Almost there.
He's sobbing.
We're gonna get it's part of the deal, dude. We're gonna go out this door, we're gonna walk.
Wow, this dude is fucking like this cop must feel bad. Did he pat his back? He has his hand on his back. Look at that.
So you'll have to make a decision now, but just start thinking about it.
So the cops don't like the old fucking movie theater thing where you put your arm on the side, then you move it. When Buchanan starts sobbing violently, the police officer just places his hand directly on his back for comfort. That's very interesting. That kind of thing doesn't normally happen. I wonder if it's simply his military experience, if it's the fact that he wanted to, like, this dude's just looking over like, are you fucking crying right now? And this guy doesn't give a shit. He's just trying to drive. But for whatever reason, this cop was compelled to put his hand on Stephen Buchanan's back in comfort. It's also probably uncomfortable to being in such close proximity of someone who's just violently crying. It's just awkward. It's not something normally in society, like, it's just not something that is done just to violently sob. It's uncomfortable. People don't really know how to respond to that. It violates social expectations.
It's part of the deal, dude. We're gonna go out this.
So it's part of the deal, dude.
There's a detention.
Yeah, this cop in the back feels bad.
Go, okay, all right, Steven, try to keep it together.
No one else gives a fuck, yeah. These dudes don't give a shit. People cry in jail often, so the cops, like, I guess crying in jail is one thing where the cops just, like, eventually must get so used to it.
Anything you say or statements you make may be used against you.
Steve, I'd like to talk to you some more. I'd like to do it upstairs.
Oh.
Just do me a favor and sign there. Basically,
and that's the detective. Was that the same detective who was going to... Who was going to pat his back?
Yeah, you were talking about doing things that took it to
sexual.
A different sexual
thing. Yes, sir.
So, when you say sexual, just give me an idea of what some of those sexual things, what does that mean?
Oral sex.
Wow, okay. He's admitting to it.
Penetration.
What kind of penetration?
Vaginal. And showering.
He asked if the decoy had ever done anal, so I guess he kind of implied at that too.
You know, kissing and all.
And as Chris mentioned, he wanted to record him having sex with a decoy, which would be the creation of child pornography, so that should be an additional charge too, or at least it's something that should have been considered.
All that stuff, everything that comes with kissing.
And you indicated that you want to do these things with her.
Yes, sir.
In the event that you got to see and meet her.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
I was refusing to come into the house.
No, he was not.
I had no problem talking to her, with me being outside and her being inside.
Okay.
I had no problem with that.
Okay.
But I was refusing to come into the house.
You're nervous about going inside?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Is that just because it was a house that you didn't know? You're worried about going
inside? Yes, sir.
Is it that simple? You're yes, worried sir. About that? At the moment that you were taken into
custody? Well, that's one potential option, or the other option could be that he simply wanted to maintain control of the situation. That would be easier to accomplish if the decoy departed with him in a car and went to some fucking isolated parking lot.
Very open and honest about letting us know that you had your gun in the car.
Yes, sir.
Why would you have brought that with you? Is that just due to...
I always carry it after, you know, the Marines being shot and everything with ISIS and, you know, threats to military people and whatnot.
See, he's almost making a good point, like, to say, okay, there is a real reason as to why I might need to carry a firearm. Of course, that doesn't... Whether that's a valid argument, I guess, is subject to debate, but nonetheless... Him bringing the firearm to this particular meeting, I don't think that the excuse that he carries it everywhere applies. This should have been a time to where he could have left it at home. Him bringing that was a intentional, strategic move on his part.
But I had it on me, on my waist.
I mean, and based off of the items that were with it, based on the context, the fact that he had the camera, the condoms, and the gun, that I think is a bit more... It doesn't necessarily mean that he was going to murder the decoy, but it certainly suggests and almost implies lightly that he was going to use them at some point, or that he was open to. He might not have fired the gun, but he might have brandished the gun just to coerce.
I think you guys probably found the holster for it. And so I decided to just keep it in the car, not go up there, because I thought...
So you originally did have it on your
yes.
waist. Was the gun in the holster?
No, I had taken it out, and I had actually, it was loaded, it was, you know, cocked and ready, and so I had taken the mag out, uncocked it, put the bullet back in the mag, and just put the mag back in, and so it wasn't charged or cocked, and I just put it into the bag.
Where'd you do that?
I'll say at the park, down the street.
Oh, right down the street?
Yes, I believe so, yes.
Okay. Is that when you had gotten out to walk up by
yes,
the house?
That would be so sketchy. You just go to the park, you see fucking Steve Buchanan with a fucking handgun putting it in his trunk. That must have been horrifying. If any witnesses saw that, I'd be fucking terrified.
In addition to the gun and the holster and the knife, there was also other things in the car.
Yeah.
That found.
Like what?
Do you know what those things could be?
An
excellent
condom
question.
Box?
Yeah, we found condoms in the car. Yeah, that's part of what we found, yeah.
I think a box with like 2 extra rounds because my clip only holds 9.
Okay.
Computer.
Okay, how about a camera?
A camera.
Yes, I keep that in there.
If you were me sitting in this chair...
Why would you keep a camera in your fucking truck, dude? That's just bullshit. That does not seem like something that you would do. The only reason you'd have your camera in your trunk is if you fucking put it there. Assuming that this guy has a home, and unless he's a fucking photographer, there's no reason why he'd carry around a camera. Given the context, I think we can assume sinister intent.
Show up at this location in Fairfield that you talked about with this person. And you talked about doing a variety of things with this person before meeting them.
He doesn't strike me as the
and
photographer
inside your
type.
Car, in the same bag, we find the condoms, the gun, and a camera. And if you were sitting in my seat, how would you... I mean, can you see
exactly. How? So one of the reasons that serial killers do want to become cops, or one of the reasons why a serial killer might be interested in law enforcement, is to understand the reasoning that law enforcement employs. So he's asking Stephen Buchanan, he's like, dude, think about how you would assess this situation from a law enforcement perspective. And Stephen Buchanan has enough awareness to think, okay, yeah, you're right.
Yes, no, if I had put myself in your seat, I see how bad it looks for me, and I just imagine what you're thinking and about the type of person I am and everything.
Oh,
like
a moral
that.
Evaluation.
Whether or not, you know, the stuff that I'm telling you is true or stuff that I'm telling you is false. I completely understand.
Exactly. So, I mean, he's saying, like, dude, I know that you know that I'm full of shit. And it's obvious that there's nothing that he has to gain from being honest, and he only has to lose. So he's going to craft up this defense that he didn't want to do it. He's basically in a lie, because if he told the truth, he'd get fucked.
How it works and everything.
I mean, I know this isn't an easy situation for you, and we're not trying to make it harder. You know, but at the end of the day, Steven
is so defeated.
Excuse my language, but I fucked up.
Yeah. Well, that's part of it. And acknowledging that is a big step. It's not easy to do. A lot of people will deny to the very end. That's not going to help.
Because that's the only way that you'd be able to avoid the charges in fucking jail. Dude, there's nothing to be gained. Like, the unfortunate reality, this is fucked up, but it's just the way the criminal justice system is. Dude, if you get arrested for something, talking to the cops is never a good idea. So the problem from a legal perspective, his problem right now is just talking with the police. Of course, I'm glad that he did. That he foolishly gave up his rights, but still.
I fucked up, and...
Buchanan served 3 years of a suspended 8-year sentence. He had to register as a sex offender for 10 years. As far as we know, he is not reoffended.
So that's it. That's the story of Steve Buchanan. It's obvious that this guy's a predator, but was he a serial killer? Well, there's just no way for us to know that. There's a compelling case that could be made that he might have done that murder might have been on the menu, but given the actual action of the crime, there's no way that we could know for sure. So comment down below and let me know what you think. Was Stephen Buchanan a homicidal maniac who brought a kill kit, or was he simply a fucking creeper who didn't know what to put in his trunk? Thank you everyone for listening, and until next time.